Good morning, good morning, good morning. Shall we stand together? Welcome to Tiger Covenant Church of Pastor David Greenidge. I'll say he is risen, and now all of us together say he is risen indeed. He is risen!
He is risen indeed!
We're talking about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let's give him a hand clap this morning. Again, and thank you for coming. Today's going to be a grand day. It's going to be a day filled both with music, and I'll share a short few words. We're actually going to serve communion this morning. But more than anything, I am praying for impartation of God's presence in all of our lives to help us be better people, loving people, to help change our world. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we believe in the power of prayer. Would you grab your neighbor's hands? We love to pray. We love to reach out and connect in prayer. And as we hold hands together, it's a sign of our commitment and our unity that we want God in that house more than anything. Father God, we just thank you so much that you're here. We thank you that you gave us your son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, who rose on the third day. And so we stand in your glory and in your presence, asking that you would fill us, indwell us, lead us to be your loving children, to serve others. We pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We all said,
amen.
Go bring somebody and say, it's going to be a good day.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Do you really love him?
Yeah.
Let's stand together. I have to tell y'all, I was awake last night about 4 o'clock in the morning thinking about today. And I really know that God has given us a plan for this morning. He's put these songs, these scriptures, the drama all together to celebrate and honor him. But at the end of the day, y'all, the Holy Spirit's in control this morning.
Amen.
Don't you just know something? That if God is doing something in your heart this morning, you let him.
Amen.
You expect it. Because he's alive, it makes all the difference for who we are as people today. Amen?
Amen.
He's alive. If I say he is risen, what do you say?
He is risen indeed.
That's it was a little more exciting. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
One more time. He is risen.
Oh,
and people in this church and other Christians around the world that we are going to live for God. Amen? We're going to do His will and do what He wants us to do. So we're excited about it. I would like to move now into letting you know a few things that are going to be happening in time to come to church over the next several weeks. We're excited to tell you that starting next Sunday, we're doing a 5-sermon series called Bless. Bless. And Bless is an acronym for B, for begin with prayer, L, for listen with care, E, for eat together, S, for serve with love, and the final S is share your story. And I have a wonderful outline and a take home for you every week to give you the letter of what it stands for. And I was speaking on a series of ideas and talks about how we can bless each other and, more importantly, how we can bless the community. So we want to invite you to come back over the next several Sundays to be a part of that. At this time, I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward. It's time for us to do our offering. And as you give, know that Tiger Covenant Church is a church that gives to missionaries around the world, 6 different missionaries and missionary organizations, as well as 2 home mission projects that we're giving. Every portion of our offering is to give and to share. Let's bow our heads in prayer. As you give, I ask you to give liberally. God is blessing us, and we want you to be blessed in the ministry of giving. Father, we just thank you for your people as they give liberally and generously. We ask, God, that you would keep the devourer from our backs as we obey your word and give us unto God. We ask your people would be blessed. We pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
feast of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Where do you want us to prepare and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" He replied, "Go into a city to a certain man and tell him, 'My teacher says my appointed time is near. I'm going to celebrate the Passover with my disciples at your house.'" So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus was reclining at table with the 12. And while they were eating, he said, "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me." They were all very sad and began to say to him, one after the other, "Surely not I, Lord." Jesus replied, "The one who is dipped in me. The Son of Man will go, just as it is written about him, but woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." Jesus answered, "Yes, it is you." While they were eating, Jesus took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Take, eat." Then he took the cup and gave thanks and offered them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins."
Make your peace with God. Make
love to him and walk in your blessing.
Now was the governor's custom each year during the Passover celebration to release one prisoner to the crowd, anyone they wanted. This year, there was a notorious prisoner, a man named Barabbas. As the crowds gathered before Pilate's house that morning, he asked them, "Which one do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" He knew very well that the religious leaders had arrested Jesus out of envy. Just then, as Pilate was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent him this message: "Leave this innocent man alone. I suffered through a terrible nightmare about him last night." Meanwhile, the leading priests and elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas to be released and for Jesus to be put to death. So the governor asked again, "Which one of these two do you want me to release?" The crowd shouted back, "Barabbas!" Pilate responded, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" But they shouted back again, "Crucify him!" "Why?" Pilate demanded. "What crime has he committed?" But the mob roared even louder, "Crucify him!" Pilate saw that he wasn't kidding anyone, and that a riot was beginning to develop. So he sent for a bowl of water, and he washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. The responsibility is yours." And all the people yelled back, "We will take responsibility for his death. We and all our children." So Pilate released Barabbas to them. He ordered Jesus to be flogged with a lead-tipped whip. Then he turned him over to the Roman soldiers to be crucified.
Crucified.
Son Jesus the Word, the living proof. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, giving nothingness formation. And by his word he sustains the power of his name. For he is before all things and over all things. He is holy, and holy is his name. So praise him. The way he perseveres, the humble Son of God becoming the perfect sacrifice. Praise him for his death. And he really stood in our place. And he lovingly endured the grace. And he battled the enemy. And on the third day rose.
Angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat up.
you've heard the gospel message, and I just want to give you four recapping thoughts of what you just heard. Number one, Jesus has shown his power over sin, death, and the enemy. Let the church say amen. Now, sometimes we're looking for a real leader. We've had various political leaders in the history of the United States come and go. We've had various political leaders, military leaders in the history of the world come and go. We've had various prophets come and go. We've had various good people, good women, good men come and go. And people have been enamored in the halls of history with different figures because what they said seems to lift up our hearts. But saints of God and people that are gathered here this morning, I want to let you know that there's only one person that stands alone for all time and for all eternity, and his name is Jesus Christ. He stands above the crowd. He stands above the rest because not only is he the Son of God, but he is God. He's the only one that ever on his own accord and own power died and rose from the dead and reigns victoriously. So because he rose and because he has the power over death, this is not a joke. This is not just a myth, a story, a possibility. This is fact. The history of the books in history have been written. The case is in, it's closed. And there are many witnesses that saw Jesus rise from the dead. So he's the only one that has the power over heaven and hell and death itself. Point number one, Jesus has shown his power. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Point number two, we're not alone. Jesus lives, and he will never leave us or forsake us. Do you realize that he lives in my heart? He lives in your heart. And say to God, the people that are here this morning, he is the true answer to the ills of the world. He's the true answer for the discord that we find racially existing between folks. He's the discord between nations that are against nations. He's the answer for the problems that exist in the far remote corners of the world and even right in my own house. He is the answer. When even the problems in my own house, he's the answer. And when we turn to him and ask for his help and his guidance, amazing things happen. And the scripture says he'll never leave us or forsake us. In Matthew chapter 5, Matthew chapter 28, which is our key verse. Matthew 28. This is what it says. It says, after the Sabbath had dawned, the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. It was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and just as the choir sang, came to the tomb and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were as white as snow. The guards were so afraid that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, here's the key verse. Notice that it was the women who were the first one to see our resurrected Lord. Amen, women.
Amen.
The angel said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. So this scripture that I just read affirms what I just said, that Jesus has shown his power over sin. And the angel said he's not here because he demonstrated his power. He rose from the dead. And then point number two, we're not alone. The scripture affirmed that too because the angels came to the woman. They were lonely. They were despondent. They had just saw their Savior killed by Roman officials. But now the angel comes to them and Jesus himself came to the woman, disclosed himself to them, and then what did he do? He told them to go. Verse 8, so the woman hurried away from the tomb, afraid, yet filled with joy, and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers, go to Galilee. There they will see. So Jesus appears to the women, comforted them. Jesus then appeared to the disciples in Galilee, just like he said a few moments later. He appeared to the disciples. He appeared to all 12 except one. who took his life. And Jesus is here. What's the relevance today for what I'm talking about? What's the relevance today for all of us that's here? What does it mean? How does it relate to me where I am in my pain? How does it relate to me in my whatever circumstance I'm in this morning? Well, here's how it relates. If you open up your heart to him and allow his amazing grace to flood your soul on a daily basis, you will not be the same. So I have a charge that I want to give to every person here this morning. A charge is an admonition. A charge is a kind of like a spark that can get you where you need to be and get you off the dime. And here's the charge. You need to commit your total being and heart to Christ. If you're a believer in Christ, sometimes as believers we get a little bit lax. We get a little bit recoiled. We get a little bit comfortable. And the word of the Lord this morning is that Jesus wants a great night for you. Excuse me. For you to be where you need to be. And that's to be on fire for God. No longer as Christians can we sit back and be silent and not speak up when we see somebody put down, when we see somebody put out, when we see somebody stepped on. It's up to us. Care about people that are in bad conditions and be willing to take a stand and to do what it takes to help people that are in a bad way. So I'm asking every Christian to take your stand and to do what God is calling you to do. Christians say amen.
Amen.
And then there's a comfort here. There's a comfort for all of us. Because if you do what God is calling you to do, you're going to stand before God one day and we too are going to be changed. The scripture tells us that we too will rise, point number three, as the Apostle Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, this is what it says. Verses 44, these are some amazing verses. This is no joke. It's the earnest truth. So it will be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown perishable, it will be raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it will be raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it will be raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it will be raised a spiritual body. Saints of God, that means that all of us here that accept Jesus, and this is the truth, that one day our mortal bodies are going to be done away with. And everybody here that accepts Christ gets a new body. And here's the good news. God decided in his heart, before you were born, that he wanted every one of his earthly children to be with him. And he made a way for the whole world to be saved. And so our job as believers is to let as many people know that they don't have to stay in their misery and stay in their stuff, but they can move from there to a place of joy, happiness, peace, and love, and a relevant, conscious, ongoing person that stands for truth, that stands against injustice, and wants to see people's lives healed and changed by the power of God. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
So you're all going to get a new body. It's going to be raised, it's going to be a spiritual body, it's going to be a supernatural body. And then point number four, all things wrong will be eventually made right. All things made wrong will be eventually made right. And here's a sobering scripture in Revelations. Revelations chapter 21. Listen to what the word of the Lord says. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. And there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem coming down from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people. And God himself will be with them, their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the older order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of water of life. He who overcomes will inherit this, and I will be his God, and they will be my sons. But the coward, here's the admonition now. The unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. Here's the good news. God did not intend, God did not desire, God did not want any of his earthly creation to experience life apart from him. But God desired every one of us in this world, every one of us, to be with him. And if you will turn your heart to him, you can experience the joy and peace on earth now and an experience for all eternity. And my desire as a gospel preacher is that all of you together would be in that number when you see your God face to face. You know, here's a revelation that God gave you. Some people come to faith in Christ early in their lives. Some people come to faith in Christ later on in their lives. Some people recognize on their deathbeds. As a pastor, I go to hospitals and I visit with people, and I see people in desperate times, and I have the privilege. One story just stands out. A guy, he had a week to live. And that's what the doctors told him. Sometimes the doctors get it right, sometimes they're a little off. A lot of times they're kind of intermixed, they're pretty close, they can see the signs. And they said he had about a week. This guy made peace with all of his family members. Hadn't really been walking with God. Hadn't come to his bedside. He wanted to pass away at home. Had all his family come. And the first thing he did was make his peace with God. And he asked me to pray with him and lead him to the Lord. And I did. He accepted Christ 7 days. First day filled with joy. Second day happy, glad. Third day still praising God. Came back, reading scripture, praising God. One point it got so good that the family members were there and they were laughing in the background. He said, cut that out. The pastor's here. I want to pray with this man. And then the next thing he did was he went to all of his family members and made his peace with them, asked for forgiveness, blessed them, and then about 2 days later, he died. Here's what God showed me from that story. Some people will come to faith in God at the end of their lives. They're in heaven. Some people come to God in the early part of their lives, and they live for God, and they're able to lead many people to God. They're in heaven. Some people use their gifts for God because they realize that God has touched them, that God has healed them. Just like the choir has sang so beautifully this morning. These people up here use their gifts, and Deborah, give them a hand clap. But you know how God's mercy works? He told the story of some people. Everybody stands his feet. He told the story of some people who had to be hired by a guy who had work. Excuse me. And he said, I'm going to pay you guys a certain wage. And he quoted the price. And he said, every hour you work, I'll pay you. But he said something different with his agreement with these guys. He said, I'm going to pay you what I decide to pay you. Some starting early in the day. Some carrying the work from later in the day. At the end of the day, when he was handing out the paycheck, you know what he did? He gave everybody the same amount. So the guys who worked early said, that ain't fair. We worked all day long. Why does this guy come to the end of the day? Why does he get the same thing that we got when we slaved the whole day? And basically, the end of the story ends with, I am the employer, and I made an agreement with you to come to work. I kept my agreement to pay you. And so don't worry if I was generous and decided to pay others. You know what that story is indicative of? Our Heavenly Father. Some of you will come to faith early in your life, and when you do so, middle in your life, when you do so, you're blessed. But some come later on in your life. And the Master of heaven and earth still holds wide his arms of love
to all of us. He says, whosoever will, let him come. I had an uncle who did that very thing. Lived his life apart from God. And at the very end of his life, he gave his heart to the Lord. And then on his deathbed, he had about a month left. He's crying, tears in his eyes. Wish I would have did waste a lot of years. Because there's joy in serving the Lord. This is the real deal. So some of you may not ask Christ to come into your life today if you're not believers. You may do it tomorrow. You may do it the day after. You may do it years later. But the point is, you've heard the word and let the Spirit of God lead you to your final resting place, which is in heaven, which starts now on earth. But the choice is yours. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm going to ask several groups of people to come forward at this time. If you need healing in your body, I'm going to ask you to come forward. If you need salvation in your soul, I'm going to ask you to come forward. If you're a believer and you know you haven't been walking with God like you need to, and need to get close to Him, I'm going to ask you to rededicate and commit to Him. I've asked my theatrical disciples to come forward because they're going to be up here to greet you when you come. I want you to see something that you didn't come with this morning. You don't have to be perfect. You don't have to be anything. You just come if you have a need. The altar of the Lord is open. What does that mean? That means you take a step of faith and just come forward as I'm speaking now. Just start. Those of you start coming, don't be shy. Just don't come. And just shake one of their hands and say, I need prayer. And then I'm going to lead you in prayer. And then in prayer. Just say, I need something from the Lord. And as you come this morning, the Bible says, whosoever that calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And if you're a Christian, you want to recommit, do that. If you need healing in your body, do that. Whatever it is you need from God, He wants to bless you. He wants to touch you right now. This is your home. This is your day of salvation. This is your day of healing. Come and receive something from the Lord. When you go to a good restaurant, maybe you're at the church, you go to a good restaurant. You go to a good restaurant, you don't just sit up here at the restaurant when you're hungry and not order and not eat. When you're in the house of God and you need food, soul, need some healing. I remember when I said that day when I asked God to come into my life and save, that day when I rededicated my life to God and I got baptized, that day when I decided I was going to start living for the Lord. I was living up in Seattle at this time. Oh, something rich happened to my soul, and I started realizing it wasn't just about making money. And yes, God did bless me most of my life. I've actually not worked being a pastor most of my life. I worked in the business world. But these last 12, 15 years of my life, I've been pastoring on a full-time basis, and I wouldn't exchange for anything in the world. And I want you to revisit
a benediction, a prayer, and go out of this place with the power of the Lord. As our worship leader, Sister Deborah, does a good job. Say amen.
Amen.
And ask our church family over the next, either later on today before you leave or next week, if you want to give a special offering to bless her, feel free to do that. She's done a good job. You can release your hands. Let's give her a hand clap and the team. Receive the benediction of the Lord. May you go in the power of His love, care.